In this video, we're going to talk a little bit about how you can test tubes. I'm going to show you very, very fast and easy how you can test the most common and dual triodes like the ECC81, 82 and 83. I think this covers more or less 90% of all your everyday applications, more or less. This is a very, very normal tube. And they got different names depending on if you're from Europe or US or if you're using military tubes. It's a little bit annoying. So because I've been sorting out all my tubes, so that is why I had to write all the different names and numbers on my boxes here. And then I was doing a lot of testing and putting in them into different boxes, some of the failed ones. That's actually ECC83s. I was doing exactly the same with the other boxes the other few days. But I wanted to show you a very, very simple test circuit. So this is the test circuit that I am using. It consists of two anode resistors of 100K. And then two cathode resistors of 1K. And the two grids, they go to ground. And the two ends of the filament also go to ground. So that means the center point of the filament is my plus 6.3 volt. I use DC for the filament. And for my test, I use a regulated DC supply with a current limit of 500 milliamps, because the filament of a hot tube will consume about 300 milliamps, and I really like to use a current limited supply for filament, and that is so I don't see any flash up when I start up my tubes, because if you use a power supply capable of delivering many amps, you will see the filament light up really, really too much, really. In a real circuit, you will definitely have a power supply that is not too too strong for the job. So what I'm using here is on the anodes, the 100K resistors. I use, I think this is a 2 or 3 watt resistors. I think 1 watt is actually enough. What you want is you want to be able to handle if there is a short in your tubes, because you're testing old crappy tubes, right? So there could be, of course, all sorts of shorts. So you want to use resistors that can handle the short. And you also want to use a regulated DC for the anode supply. I'm actually using a really, really old HP supply. I set the voltage for 250. As you can see here, and that is of course also checked here. I just turned on the power supply here, so I need to fine adjust the voltage a little bit while it is warming up. So that is my 250. I really recommend you have a power supply where you can turn off the high voltage. This way you can play around putting in tubes while you are testing and stuff like that, so you don't get electric shocks or anything stupid, because 250 could maybe tickle your fingers a little bit. So in this case, it's an ECC83 I'm testing here. I also wrote the pin numbers on the tube. Look at that. This is pin 1 and this is pin 9, and you count clockwise seen from the bottom. That is always how it's done with this socket, by the way. So if I plug in my 83 tube, I will see immediately filament heat up, and then I got my 3.6 volts and then about 300 milliamps. You need to wait a little bit more than this. This is now the filament is warm, but it will take a little bit time before the filament actually heat up the cathode as well, and then you get a good emission from the cathode. And then you can turn on your anode supply. And then this is the two anodes. I've connected them to 2 voltmeters like this. If you only got 1 voltmeter, you can of course move it, or you can have a little switch that will change between the two anodes. I'll here show you a little table of optimal values in case the tube is good or nominal. So for an ECC83, the optimal voltage with a circuit like this is 145 volts. So what I see here is a little bit higher voltage, so that means my emission is lower. The tube is not pulling the nominal current, and this is also what I should see with my tube tester. So let's take the same tube and put it in my tube tester and see if this is correct. Also, I see a very, very little difference between the two currents. Not a lot, but I do see it is visible, right? So here is my little handy tube tester. I really recommend you use one of these rubber condoms. Actually, you used to call them that when you are working with tubes, pulling them in the socket or pulling them in and out like that, because it's actually doing a few things for you. Because of this rubber, it grips really, really nice and good to the glass, and that means you don't push that hard to the slippery glass. It's just super easy to pull it up, bada bing, bada boom, and you don't push on the glass, and you don't break the glass. There's actually also some other things that this is doing. It allows you to work with hot tubes. And the last but not least thing, sometimes, very, very rarely, it is possible that a tube will break, explode, and splinter between your fingers. Can you imagine what happens when you're pushing real hard on a glass tube like this and then it shatters between your fingers? I mean, the damage to your fingers is just intense. Of course, it's very, very rarely this can happen, but if the socket or some of the pins are half bad or something is wrong with the tube and you're trying to do this, I mean, yes, it can definitely happen. But with this one, it's going to save your fingers and you will have a happy, happy day. So definitely get you one of these if you're working a lot with tubes. Or be very, very careful. Of course you can do this with your fingers. I see most people do this, but just be really, really gentle and be careful. And yeah, you can get hurt. All right, so this tube tester here is configured for ECC83. I don't want to talk a lot about this tube tester because it is covered in another video. What I will do is I will just go straight to test, and let's just test this tube and see if it works. And what we see now here is the heat up. And I can, with this switch here, I can change between the two triodes in this tube. And probably we can see this is the amplification and this is the anode current at, of course, correct settings with all the voltages and stuff correctly set up for this tube. And the correct nominal gain would be 1.6. And this is 1.4 something. And current will be a little bit more than this, right? So this is, where are we, 3? So this is, it should be, I think about here, right? 1.2 or something like that. 1.2 milliamps, if I don't remember this wrong. So this is one of them, and this is the other one. See, the other one is a little bit lower, very little, but it is a little bit lower. Definitely also, see, a little bit higher, a little bit lower. And also, what I see here is a little bit lower gain and also a little bit lower current, exactly like this little super simple DC tester told me. It also told me, yes, the tube is more or less okay, but a little bit low on emission and a little bit low on gain is what I should be able to expect, and a little bit, tiny little bit of difference between the two triode parts. So that is just wanted to show you. Again, I've tried a million gazillion tubes with both the tester and the super simple DC tester, and yes, this one is actually capable of revealing bad tubes. Maybe I should try and take a bad tube and show you. Okay, so let's look at this one. So this is also an ECC83. Well, look at that. One is low, I mean, really low, and this one is very, very low, like almost no emission at all, right? Because remember, we got 250 volts, and I see almost all the voltage over here, so it's really, there's nothing going through that tube. So let's see how that one looks on the AVO. So a normal gain for an ECC83 is 1.6. And one of them is doing about 1. And it's 1.2 milliamps is normal. And look at that, almost no current. And if I go and check out the other one, like I said, nearly no current at all, and just absolutely no gain at all. This gain is under half of rated current, or rated gain. By the way, did I ever tell you about this super cowboy trick? Some people will definitely call this a used car salesman's trick. How can you sell crappy tubes as new tubes? Let's see if that trick works on this particular tube. But there is a trick to recover tubes. I really hate to show you this, but recovery is a thing, right? So let's see the values again. 1 and 0.4, right? And yeah, again, yeah, see, the current is absolutely nothing, right? So this is the good one. Oh, the best part of it is even bad. Here is the filament voltage on this machine here. And it is, of course, at the moment set for 6.3. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to crank the filament voltage up to 9.3, and then we're going to wait a little bit, and then we're going to see what happens. Because now I'm going to overheat the tube. This is not a lot. The tube can easily handle this. See, this is only 9 volts. It can easily do double this if you want to speed up the progress, by the way. But as you can see here, already we are having normal gain, and we're having normal current for the good one, and the bad one is almost okay. So what we can do is we can actually crank this up further, or we can just give it a little while. There's also another way to speed up the progress, and that is to crank up the current like that. So now I'm doing 3 times the normal anode current to heat up the tube as much as I can. And then all the particles and all the bad things that was on the plates is burned a little bit away. And then we're going to go back to 6.3 volts. And of course, the tube is going to cool down a little bit. But the fun thing is, most of the time when you do this, it's actually going very, very close to acceptable limits, and it's actually passing as a acceptable good tube. I've done this a few times, and it is quite a nasty, nasty trick. See, the value is now 1.2. Let's see how the bad one is. Ooh, it's still 0.4. So the restore of this particular tube did not go as well as it is actually doing sometimes, or I didn't do it enough time. 1.1. Of course, this wasn't super long time for this experiment, but I really, if you got an instrument like this or any other way to manipulate filament and the currents, you can try and do this for some experiments and see what happens. I've done it a few times, and it actually stays good for a very, very long time. So, but not on this one. It's just super duper stupid for the demo effect. I could, of course, picked another one and then show you it would work, but it's, I think it's more fun when stuff actually fails, but I definitely want you to go and try this if you want to. I'm actually a little bit back now. I've spent a few more minutes, but only like 5 minutes playing around with some more filament overloading, overheating of this tube to burn out all the impurities, and as you can see, it is the same tube. And look what happened. This is nominal gain, and this is nominal current. So yes, I was of course able to do this, but it took me 5 more minutes. How annoying, huh? But the other one is a little bit low, but I mean, definitely within spec. I mean, 1.4 is not really that low. It's definitely not enough to call this a bad tube. 1.6, remember, that was the nominal. And 12, 1.2 milliamps is normal. Let's try the other one again. See? I got my nearly 1.6, but I got my 1.2 milliamp. So now, this completely defect, completely trash tube is back in operation. That is so much fun. And definitely like you would sell an old used car to some fool. Yes, you could sell this tube or put it into some equipment and get it out the door. And probably the customer's not going to know anything about this at all ever, because it will actually stay good for a very, very long time. It is absolutely crazy. All right. Thank you very much for watching. Come back soon.